Good morning, everybody. The laser isn't working, so I will use my fingers. My presentation is essentially food for thought. I will certainly take extreme positions to trigger the brain cells to work. So what is the meaning of the flat world? And I use five basic ideas. One is that in a flat world, the line of sight can see a lot of things. And the first thing that you tend to see is price transparency. The second thing which you and I get as consumers is access to information. Often when we go to a store, we know more about the product than the retailer himself. The third phenomena is the fact that cross-border, I can buy goods from anywhere in the world, and anybody's control of a pipeline to sell a product to me is dead and gone. And the most important phenomena is the idea of a single click to touch anything in the world. But what has all this done is that it has completely changed the way you and I shop. And I think the biggest impact of managing in a retail in a flat world is where you and I have changed. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to mix technology, globalization, and then see what is this triangle and what's the way going through this maze, if it's a maze. So we as consumers are essentially always on. But what is the phenomena which is undergirding all this is that there was a time when we were evolving, but the digital world has made us devolve to an extent that the smartphone, which is essentially such an intuitive device, is now capable of being used by anybody. See it at an airport, see it in a restaurant, and see the age profile of the customer, potential customer, because that's a child using a smartphone. And what this has actually ended up doing is that because there is information access and price transparency, I will sit in a store and reject the store as a sales phenomenon. Let's look at price for a minute, and this is just a trigger which I'm going to give you. On a certain day, the same product is sold at this price, 100, 1, 7, 1, 1. But in the books of the retailer, he's losing 6.5% and 9.9. But take another product, he's losing 44%. So the whole issue of what the digital world has done to the balance sheet and the profit and loss account of the retailer, both the e-commerce player as well as the brick and mortar, is a big issue. And when you look at this, a product in India of a global retailer, which is the last alphabet of the English language, sells at 33% cheaper than what they sell in their own country. If the scale of the impact has to be assessed from the price disparity, then the second phenomena is that 52% people are comparing the price in the store. And often, we always end up saying that the percentage of e-commerce business is not such a large percentage, it will plateau off. But the reality is that we are binary consumers. 90 to 97% of consumers are shopping both the web and the physical. And that is the dramatic impact. Why are we binary consumers? Because when we get into a store, I want to try it, buy it, and it's close to me. But when I'm sitting at home and I'm always shopping, it ends up being any one of these five. And it's our experience. Okay, thank you. Yeah, it kind of works. So my presentation and analysis is not going to be qualitative. I want to be very focused on the fact that all of us come from the world of business. We are in the business of making returns, And any amount of qualitative talk is irrelevant. I'm also a firm believer that brick and mortar isn't going to go away, but it was never an either-or question. Anybody who presents it as an either-or option desperately needs to reflect. Look upon the issue of information. How many of you, us are aware that Amazon is the search engine for shopping? Clearly reflecting the nature of change that has happened in our lives. And the fact that I have convenience is visible. I can, on a cell phone, I have a greater variety to purchase than the largest mall in the world. And but who's responsible for this? Is it the retailer? Is it the customer? The issue is that the global community is one very, very big phenomena which is influencing retail. You and I are embedded customers in communities. And very often, as Alok said, his news comes on WhatsApp. It doesn't come from the traditional channel. So this is a huge impact on the nature of buying. If we are customers today, then we have to realize that we are always shopping. We are always shopping because I have a capacity to search, I'm a part of a community, I have information, and I have price. I don't need anything else. So the question then arises that in this embedded world of the consumer, is a brand going to be different? 80% of CEOs believe that their brand is different, but customers actually perceive only 8% of brands to be different. The extent of commoditization in retail is very, very rapid. And so if this was the consumer side of the story and what the globalized world has done, then let's look at how companies respond. Are the old models working? Certainly no. And one thing which companies have to learn is that they cannot change an empowered customer. If 65% of people below the age of 43 are prepared to switch from a store when physically sitting in a store, don't try, as a retailer, brick and mortar retailer, don't try to change them. People have tried to wish it away. This is Hilton's old CEO saying, we do not believe there's a material impact on the bulk of our markets with our core business and leisure consumers. This is the reality. Airbnb, 3 times the size of Hilton at any moment of time. And as we all know, we are the country from where Oyo has grown up. That scale is getting even more rapid. If Uber says that our entire goal is to get the cost of taking an Uber below the cost of owning a car, what has been the impact? The impact has been that the costs of travel expenses in companies' accounts have continued to fall, and Uber value has continued to rise. These are dramatic changes. You can't wish them away. I have a lot of respect for Jack Ma. The 8-year-old consumer, which is today using a cell phone, is going to come and tell you that this is the way to order food. And this is real experience in the geography in which I stay, which is the Middle East. If you talk to a school kid and they are deciding in an evening what to eat, it's talabat. And even if I wish this was not true, but the foot traffic trends have continued to decline. However much we may argue, even in India, where I have looked at the performance of 250 odd stores for the last 6 years, everybody says demonetization was bad, but actually the real impact of demonetization was positive. What happened is that 15 days after demonetization, our average selling prices, our average transaction values started to rise, our sales started to rise, but our number of customers continued to fall. And therefore, the roles and rules of this business called retail are going to change, have to change. This is one of my most congested slides, but I'm now taking the point of view of a retailer and saying that I have 5 ways of reaching to the consumer. I have either I can franchise my business, I can have my own stores, I can have my own website, or I can go to an e-commerce brand and a marketplace. And the mental makeup of the retailer is that these 3 give him a lot of sales, these 2 allow him to control price. And this is going to tell us why, since 2015, has this industry called retail and digital started to transform. So what happened in 2015 when the first acceleration of e-commerce took off in the world and America realized that it was time to start shutting stores was the fact that our experience with a brand was no longer consistent in a store. I would go to a store, I would love a style, and I would not get it in stock. So the first thing which I did, I was motivated to go on the net. The second thing which happened is that as e-commerce was rising, sales started to plateau, and companies which were brand owners had inventory pile up. So what did they turn around and do? Discount it and sell, which resulted in what? A slower growth. And then incentive to open e-commerce. So it was you were kind of sandwiched if you were a brand owner. And then the price transparency came up. Many of you must be knowing Everlane. Everlane on its website tells you the price of the product at the point of manufacture and the price that it puts its ticket on. And it also tells you what a competitor would be pricing it for without telling you the name of the competitor. This is the scale of transparency, not just price, but even cost. And therefore, once you started investing in your own e-commerce to grow your business, brands that is, and in digital marketing, all the brands predominantly realized they were not as effective as Amazon. And then your profits went down and Amazon's and Alibaba's supremacy went up. In a single day, Levi sold more than 1 million pairs on Alibaba when it launched. That's a huge, staggering number. And over time, what I have seen in my experience over the last 8 years, that big brand names which were originally giving responsibility to partners have started to reduce their role and take control of various functions. And I want to bring Zara into this picture because the focus was inventory control went into the brand's hands, they took control of marketing, and they took greater control on price. Now, this one theoretical slide in my presentation, the foundation of the business of Zara is a very simple thought process. The maximum money you make is in design, and the second large margin you make is in retail. Manufacturing has no money left in it. And therefore, if this is the phenomena, when e-commerce is compressing your margins, what does the brand want to do? They already have this. They better try to take control over this. And therefore, what we are now seeing, everybody is starting to mimic Zara. And in that phenomena, the capture of value has accelerated in favor of the brands. Now, in terms of money, there's a very important return impact which comes from Amazon. A CEO's goal is essentially return on invested capital, right? And I'm giving you real numbers. A business which I used to run, this is 2016, had a return of X. In 17, I had an 18% decline in return on capital invested with a 5% decline in traffic. And in 2018, I had a 35% decline in ROCI with a 15% decline in traffic. That's a dramatic impact for any business to survive. So how do you compete with e-commerce, which is actually, you're not competing with e-commerce, you're competing with private equity. So let's look at it. This is the hand sketch of Jeff Bezos when he started creating Amazon. I will give a good selection, a good experience, traffic, I'll get sellers, I'll get a low cost structure and low price. Comes out of a textbook. And I want to give you Zivame's numbers of 2018. And Zivame is typical. In India, you pick up a retailer who's an e-commerce player making money. 86 crores revenue, 32 crores loss, investments of 126. It's had three CEOs in the last 3 years. And the logic is that when there's too much money, it's like gasoline, and you put it into private equity, into e-commerce, this is what happens, because they aren't chasing P&L. And Kapil used the word unicorn. Not many people know unicorn is a mythical beast. It's unreal. And everybody compares a real e-commerce to an unreal beast. And everybody talks of this crazy word called GMV. It means nothing. It's an artificial number. But why do you do it? Because there's so much money, even before 12 months are finished from the first round of equity injection, there's a second round of equity injection. Less than 12 months, there's a third round. Very often, three rounds in a year. It's passing the parcel. Nobody knows how to make money, really. Why? What are you doing? The fear of missing out on 1.8 billion people of a country with $1,705 as GDP, expected to become $10,000, everybody is saying, somebody will figure it out. Let's look at America for rationality. 7 years, gross margins of, sorry, the gross margins of Amazon competitors declined by just 2%. But their gross numbers didn't. They never lost margin. They lost the top line. And Amazon's price advantage was 9% as compared to its average price of its competitors, gaining market share. And the biggest impact in its balance sheet is not trading in goods. It's getting you to take membership and fulfillment by Amazon. That's its core business. It's a distributor. Net operating margins of Walmart went down by 10%. How? If there's a decline in return on capital invested, decline in net numbers, how do you survive? And leave aside the numbers. Amazon's experience score with customers is the highest in many categories. So the customers love it. And what the second thing which Jeff Bezos did was to say that once I build an infrastructure which starts doing this, I will do fulfilled by Amazon because of the improved efficiency and my cycle will keep growing. Again, nobody tells you that the only money they make is from Amazon Web Services. It's a digital company. It's not a digital retail company. That's an incidental business. And data, we always say, is the new oil. How many of us are aware that if you order groceries on Amazon and you order milk on a particular day, it is able to predict after a while when your reorder for milk will happen? And do you think you get the best price the second and the third and the fourth time round? So if business is now in an Amazon world, what capabilities should a company develop to do retail? First of all, I'm going to disagree with Kapil a bit. Digital, e-commerce, retail, the word omnichannel should be banned. Because these are words coined by consultants who've never run businesses, who want more assignments. So they come and tell you that let's get inventory visibility and you will be able to fight Amazon. Digital is not a channel. Don't look at the center of this, but there are two elements to retail. One is the physical, which we all experience at a store level, but more important is the digital touch points. We are consumers who are embedded in a digital world with n number of touch points. The traditional Kotler's way of defining a journey, become aware, evaluate, purchase, is all dead and gone. Kotler should no longer even be taught in business schools. This is the consumer. I buy from 20 different opportunities. I'm like the center of the universe as a human being, as a consumer, with all these digital touch points around me. And let's also stop looking on a consumer as transaction. More are my digital engagements in a relationship with the consumer. Everything starts to work. And of late, that small device which has changed the world, changed the consumer, is now the center of marketing. And I'm now going to slowly get into this word called marketing. So again, I will tend to disagree with the use of hybrids. Again, coined by consultants. Do these things work? They haven't survived. I think it's not the technology that we have to adapt ourselves to. It's the way we think about digital. And whatever we may try to do, if we try to glue the problem called disruption, we aren't going to solve it. We aren't going to get and say that I have a retail business and I have an e-commerce business. One is declining, one is rising, one is losing money, one loses hell of a lot of money. How do we fix this? Let's believe that we are in a world where you are digital and you have multiple channels to reach them. The consumer will buy from any channel he or she feels. And e-commerce capability is now hygiene. I have n number of startups in Bangalore which will come and set up a website for me, whatever is to be the scale of my company, in a matter of few days. If you have a good coding guy in your team, you can probably set up a website in 5 days. It doesn't take long. It's hygiene. But what is the biggest issue that after you have a website, where is this capability? Where is your capacity to help a consumer discover you? Where do you end up educating the consumer? How do you win his trust? How do you then convert him and then make him an advocate of your business? This is where the retail journey actually begins. When you're sitting on the pot in the morning with an iPad in your hand. It does not start at a retail store. And I, as a consumer, can flip from one channel to another in an absolutely frictionless way. And why this is important? Because on the entire journey, I better have right engagement with the consumer. If I don't have the right engagement, this is what happens. Right? And I need to just, that you just get, this is so complicated. Tech specs, which number to call, is it optimized for mobile, that it just doesn't work. That's the idea of frictionless, Amazon's real capability. So let's also believe that the digital has actually smacked us right in the middle. The Amazon trajectory is going to take our return down. And if reinvention is needed, reinvention is damn risky. Future is going to be before us, even before we can realize and say, oops. And often I hear people, the big retail players in India, give these famous interviews with magazines and say the 1.8 billion are going to take care of it. Sorry, the 10-year-old knows only Amazon. And any amount of irrational complacency of a brick-and-mortar player is going to be a problem. And this is not a growth strategy. The strategic choices we have is a new mindset, and I'm going to be very specific on how I define this. That old thinking and new technology is bound to fail. And this is the most congested slide, but I'm going to spend a little time on it. I'm not going to take you through the numbers, but Amazon's P&L has a word called fulfillment, marketing, technology and content, and general administration in the P&L of the balance sheet, the first place where Amazon declares its performance. The same thing for a brick and mortar player. What does it have? Selling, general and admin expenses. The focus of these two people is completely on different things. In the old world, you devoted 30% of time building a service and then tom-tomming it, but it's flipped around. And I'm going to show you the P&L of a listed retailer in India. And this is the same all over. In the P&L, other expenses is scheduled number 25. And schedule number 25, which is called other expenses, which people don't bother about, even in an internal MIS report, has advertising and publicity at that level. These are two people in the same business with completely different way of thinking. On one side, the guy who's doing digital knows exactly what to do with the consumer. And the guy who's come from traditional retail is still stuck in the legacy of the past. And you can do what you want. You can't take a piecemeal view anymore. The day has gone. And so the word is framing. When I frame my problem in a particular way, I decide what to see. So here is a window, which is like a frame, and you're seeing a building. And here is a window where I'm seeing greenery. And here is a window, I'm seeing the rain. And the reality is, this is the same sight. The question is that if our mindset as managers of a retail business, defined as a one-to-one transaction, whether digital, whether e-commerce, whether physical, we are going to continue to have these problems. And the choice is not easy. When return on a declining business has to be discussed, allocating capital is a big deal. So do you do more of the same? You're going to go and get obsolete. Or you get into uncertainty. Very difficult decision for a human being. And that triangle, which I defined as e-commerce, retail, and digital on the other, is actually retail, media, and consumer, and that retail incorporates everything. And the key issue is return on capital invested. We are in a Taj Group property. I heard an interview of the Taj Group CEO talking about Oyo as its competitor. And he said, our traditional return on capital invested has come from properties that I own. So every time I try to give my capability of management to a property owned by a third party, my return on capital invested declines. Sales is N into selling price. OYO has control of N. You keep controlling as much of selling price as you want. And we also get newspaper reports of investment in fancy stores as a strategy to fight digital. Completely incorrect. All the examples are coming from companies which are very successful digitally and highly profit-making. So that's Burberry's. This is Nike. Yeah? This is Apple. Apple, by the way, has a productivity of $5,000 per square foot, so you can't fight the guy. Starbucks. So that's their microbrewery, where you cure the seeds before you extract the coffee. All this are fancy stuff, but this is putting the cart before the horse. And the second phenomena which I see retailers always doing is a moat effect. Cover your position. This is Sephora, which says that take a photograph of your face and I'll help you select what you need with the color palette. That's strategy. This is what I call a Disney moment. You can get as much of Disney effect to a store. If it doesn't work for return, it doesn't work. And often, CEOs end up spending 20% of the time 80% of the time on 20% of the results. What are those few critical things that I need to do to get the best return? And the biggest issue is that learn that when I have a foot traffic decline, I can't increase the asset intensity of my business. And e-commerce is not an IT problem. And it has no silver bullet. It requires serious, hard work. And what I call is, you've got to rethink everything. First of all, you've got to redefine what's value. And if you've got to get hygiene right, your basic e-commerce frictionless experience has to be under control. It doesn't cost much. That's what's frictionless. Every capability and need of a customer on a mobile device has to be met. Give more power to me when I'm engaging with you, I'm going to stick with you. I mean, you look at it. Everything that you're able to do, I'm able to do. The bigger the number of options, the better it is. And then we got to get back to the drawing board and say, what the hell is differentiation? If Uber is everyone's private driver, it's a different philosophical approach. And then, my speech was supposed to be about metrics, and I want to focus a little bit on this, not take too much of trouble. I believe metrics are a very important thing. It's like light. You put it on a number, and the company will grow. If you don't have the number in your control, you can do what you want. An e-commerce company starts measuring your conversion from the first time you touch a device with anything associated with their name. No retailer can do this. And I say no retailer, I mean no retailer. When I compete on a store business, I'm competing on the wrong issue. The fight is not about the store, it's about land. The digital guy is able to tell me in this geography how many people went to a brand called mine. Which retailer knows how many people dream up of a brand in a geography every morning? The first thing that a CEO sells, like-to-like sales and conversion yesterday in the store, is just too late. Who should lead it? And this is probably my most controversial point. If a CEO doesn't lead a digital effort, it will fail. Digital business is not a side business. It's the center of the business. And you can't create a digital technology vertical, leave the rest of the company intact. It has to be horizontal, end to end. Otherwise, the organization will have the person responsible for business results as vacant. And a CEO's job is to educate, inspire, and create a sense of urgency before the house comes down. But the problem is, when you have people, can they learn new tricks? Can I learn new tricks? Changing designations is never going to work. And I've come across a company which did this in the Middle East, that in order to become digital, they hired interns who were young people. And what happened? Didn't last 90 days. You can't fit a young millennial guy who's a cyborg, who only talks to you when the battery is dead, in an organization structure. The question is, in marketing, very simple phenomena. Marketing was always a cost center. So the CFO decided the budgets, or CFO was extra influential in the allocation process. Has any CFO ever asked a marketing head, tell me how much did you earn? Payout is easy to measure. What did you earn? Digital capability allows you to earn an organic flow of customers every day. And if this cycle is not going to continue to work, there is going to be no earning. So when we value digital e-commerce companies, we don't value GMV. We value their ability to get organic traffic and measure everything along the way. If they have that, one day or the other, the transaction margin will fall into place. Because the real asset of e-commerce is measurement and engagement and movement of traffic on the highway of the internet. And let's be clear. It's not the biggest and the best who's going to survive, but the people who are going to be most responsive to change. And no company is too big to fail. America has shown it to us. You can be any size in this domain called retail. You just may not figure it out. And the breaking ball is right next to you. You can't sleep. And I use this as a metaphor. So this is the Ganges at various points of the Himalayas. And when it reaches the plains at the first place called Haridwar, you have a sandy beach like the sea. Why? Because the drip, 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 the relentlessness of e-commerce is going to break any retailer's back. If you keep putting short-term fixes, it just isn't going to happen. And what I'm focusing on, get the digital movement to physical conversion under control. Can't do this kind of marketing where you'll figure it out later. You go to build hygiene. And if you get it right, this is where you will be. And if you get it wrong, this is where we'll all be. Thank you. Any questions? Can I ask? Yeah.
I'm going to ask you.
Okay, you ask.
So I think, first of all, what a great session. Let's have a clap for Manoj once again.
Thank you. Thank you.
The good thing is that he woke up a lot of us, which is great. So, we're short on time. I'm going to ask a few questions on behalf of the audience. One is that, yes, you've stressed a lot upon the digital era, which is there, and you're saying digital is not an external or an extra department anymore. It needs to be into the way that you think as a business. It needs to be into your DNA. But somewhere also you spoke about how the private equity is basically running this as well.
Yep.
Amazon is one of the companies, or Jeff Bezos might be the most, you know, he's the most richest person on the planet today. And by far now, his lead is increasing every day as we speak. The question is that all these companies that we see, how profitable are we? Because at the end of the day, why are we doing business? Is to make money.
Yeah. So I think in e-commerce, it's not easy to make money. Because one of the strategies of Amazon, which we are all e-commerce players are copying, is discounting. And when you discount, the customer gets richer. So the private equity is putting money into an e-commerce company, and the e-commerce company is giving a discount, so the customer is now used to artificial value. How sensitive is this customer when the value becomes real to sustain the model? Until and unless either e-commerce discovers a model, and the e-commerce model can only be discovered, and I'm a person who's involved with large number of startups. I often ask entrepreneurs, why do you take equity? The day you take equity, you stop running the business. Because the guy who's given equity to you has to increase his value and sell off the company to somebody else. And then the chase is of gross margin, GMV as we call it, and not of cost. So cost control disappears. Most successful companies, Amazon succeeded, which not many people realize. I was in the US just starting my teaching career for 4 years. Is that he had raised $1.8 billion before the 2001 crash. And he used the $1.8 billion very, very prudently for the next 8 years. He never went back and took money. Whereas most e-commerce companies take money tomorrow, take money the third day, and want an increased value. You take a Flipkart as a classic example. And I'm just laboring a point. So I visit Amazon, Flipkart, and Myntra on the same day in Bangalore City. I ask the three CEOs, what's your goal? Myntra says, EBITDA zero. Amazon says, biggest variety in the country. Flipkart says, give me your old stock, any quantity, I'm going to sell it at 70%. Which of them has a strategy?
So interesting enough, so I think we're going to end the session now, and I'll be happy to give a token of appreciation. But just to put a closing point, you know, as interesting as it does sound, I think still e-commerce needs to figure out its way through till they become profitable.
Thank you.